Hello and welcome. I'm Kid Fury. My mum's named me Franklin Humphrey, but nevertheless, it's nice to meet you. This is Fresh Air TV. They said I had a face for radio. It's too hot for TV. Well, look at me now. I'm on your TV with me and my studio audience. Today, I have the young, talented singer-songwriter Lauren Bannon and Chris Pierce on the guitar. Please give a warm welcome for Songbird. The theme for today's show is crunch. The business world is currently getting its five a day of Brock Pocketness, and we're going to look at if and how the various creative arts are affected in these times of financial restraint. In this show, the audience here and you at home play the co-presenter. Your opinion and participation in the debate is not just necessary, it's vital, as well as our studio guests, Lauren and Chris. Today, we're going to be looking at the plethora of creative arts available to us, the human race, from graffiti to martial arts, photography to computer-aided design, music, and other stuff. So without further ado, ride with us. Fresh Air TV. First of all, I got to ask, man, has the credit crunch affected you at all?
Well, yeah, because it means that we have to actually work for a living instead of being bums.
We're broke all the time. Like.
We work for an insurance company, so it's all great. We steal money off the old people.
Our musicians are a little different these days. So
yeah.
Working for an insurance firm as well as making music.
Yeah, you've got to do the music on the side. Whereas finding the equal balance.
I gotta say, man, I have to ask you, anybody here been actually affected by the credit crunch? There's nobody's been affected by the credit crunch. So my main question is, were you all broke anyway?
They're uni students, so they're always
broke
in their own way.
So to students, when you see the credit crunch on TV, recession, the downturn, does it mean anything to you?
You just want to continue to study.
Well, it doesn't really, it means something to us because we see all around us, like, it may not affect me like directly, but we see all around us like shops closing down and stuff like that happening. Do you know what I mean? So it does affect us in a way, even though it's not directly. So maybe if we aren't poor or whatever, we do see it around us.
So how do you feel about people like me working within media? I work in a building where I'm in radio, but the TV company next door has shut, and they blame people that are using up their money on taxes, i.e. student loans and stuff like that, for a lot of this credit crunch business.
Any company which closes down should have had the contingency plans in place in the first place to deal with it. Where students have always been taking loans off, they have been for years now. If a company's not prepared for this sort of thing, then it's its own fault.
Very, very good points. So in today's show, today we're going to be looking at the plethora of creative arts available to us, the human race, from graffiti to martial arts, photography to computer-aided design, music, and so on and so on. So without further ado, ride with us, Fresh Air TV.
Well, I'm more a pencil illustrator. Traditional, I'd say. I just use pencil and paper, usually. I've developed it usually by sort of representing what I see. If I saw and you sort of style the illustration, I used to incorporate it into my own style. There's a guy called Todd Lockwood, who's a fantasy illustrator. I like fantasy a lot. Lord of the Rings is my favourite film, and I took a lot from that. And for my foundation course, I did a sort of A to Z of films. So I looked at all the scenes that I liked in films and cinema and sort of represented it on paper. I've moved away sort of from sort of copying. I'm more into sort of comic book art, sort of line drawings. Instead of sort of taking what I see, I take influences in the style of sort of taking their techniques more than representing the actual image. So there's a guy called Michael Turner who does comic book art. He's passed away, but he was one of the best sort of comic book artists. But I went through a phase where most of my stuff looked like his. A lot of people in the industry just use the computer, things like Illustrator, the program. I use Photoshop and that. I use the computer to sort of touch up my stuff. I still like to think I'm still traditional. You've got to step your game up though if you're traditional. But yeah, you can't hide away from it. You've got to use it. And sending things to print as well, you can't just do it traditionally. When it started, I did post a lot of my stuff on there, but I think there's a lot of good stuff out there. And if you flood the internet with work, all the good stuff doesn't really get seen. If you're a client and you're looking for work and you don't really know where to find it, because there's a lot of stuff on there. There's a lot of good stuff, but there's a lot of crap shit. on there as well. That's the disadvantage of the internet, because it's so accessible and easy to put your stuff on there. Anyone thinks they're an artist, anyone can just put their stuff on there. The easiest thing to do is use the internet and use the computer as a finishing tool, and use it as a way to produce more stuff in bulk, add text to things. I start on paper, I start with pencil. I'd say 90% of it is still traditional. And then I just resize it and just touch it up.
I would say graffiti got into my work by the actual style that it's in itself, the use of colour, the composition. I'm now incorporating my work into a lot of things like motion graphic work, taking my work from a 2D platform to make it more three-dimensional, more interactive, I would say. Personally, I think my motivations come from, I would say, people like Kotsu, Scene, also modern-day graffiti writers like 123 Clan, who all cooperate with graphic design as well. And also illustrative designers like Cy Scott also, who uses elements as graffiti styles as well. I've gotten quite a lot now to more digital appliances, where I like work a lot more on computer now. But it all starts from hand-based, like drawn stuff first. And I'm now, it's gone from the aspects of using programs like Illustrator, where I create better graphics using my work, and then take it into programs like Flash, After Effects, where I created it to make it more stimulating, more moving, more interactive. It's given me a new perspective on design. I now feel like I take my work even further. As artists, you'll always have your roots and sense of, like, you'll never forget where you came from as a designer or artist. In the future, we may have using a lot of technology, but the basic simplicities within art will always be there. And my simplicity in art will always be graffiti elements, I feel.
Yeah, it's real good to see some old school graffiti art there, man. Being that I was an artist at one point, I think I might give up now. So it's one of the most primitive and powerful forms of creativity. So it's real good they're still around today, even with all the techno culture that's going down. So, Lauren and Chris, do you think you're able to draw any comparisons with this art form to the music industry?
Definitely. I mean, at the end of the day, you've got to, what he says about drawing blank, it's the same. Most music and most art forms, you've got to have the talent there first. And I think industry and media is just there to enhance it at the moment. And it is going that way at the moment. You can't ignore it. The internet, everything, everyone's downloading everything. You can enhance art so much better, but you have to have the talent there to start with. So I think it's just the way it's going.
You can see where music enters art just by looking at adverts and stuff, how you select certain bits of music for adverts to mix with the art that they're going to use. So music has to have that influence as well for it to work, really. So.
Okay, so are you at a point now where you're not just trying to get music that will chart, maybe trying to get it in adverts, in computer games, movies?
I don't think you look at it to, like, you don't sit out and think, right, I want to make this for a game, unless, of course, someone asks you. But, you know, you make some good tracks and, you know, maybe someone will approach you and say, hey, this will really work in our game, we'd like that. And then we'd consider, obviously, you know, wow, that's pretty good.
You consider it.
Yeah.
That's art,
just, you know, that's art, maybe, you know.
Like, if you had asked Vincent, like, Van Gogh, if, like, he had accidentally drawn some of his things, he might have said, yeah, I was just having a bit of a laugh. Good painting, ain't it?
Wow. This next segment is a great look at how technology has progressed from illustration and has completely changed the way so many people in the industry work.
Architectural visualizer earlier. I used to do 3D architectural renderings and animations. And right now I'm a 3D artist, completely into CG films and animation as well. All through while I was doing my architecture, there were some great guys on the internet with whom I used to be on through the online forums, whom I found like some of the great artists like Branko Jovanovic and Jorge and other stuff on the 3D forums, who are like great CG 3D architectural artists. And in terms of animation and lighting, there are a whole lot of people. One of the main is like the lighting guru Jeremy Ben from Pixar. This field is rapidly changing. With every year, every half an year, you see a new piece of software coming up, and like it just makes your work so easy that you just have to be, you have to run along with the technology that's going on around. So you need to keep up pace with what's coming in new and what the developments are going on. And I feel like I need to do a lot of research on what's going on and keep in track with what's happening in and out and learn new technologies as well. In terms of 3D, architectural 3D, I can explain it because I worked in around 3 years on that, so animation is quite new to me. So in terms of architectural 3D, it was like basically using, there was softwares like 3ds Max and Cinema 4D where they had all these starting lights and they had to do with fill lights, key lights, they had to fake the illumination stuff, and slowly people started developing renderers which are like, which generate global illumination and final gathering and all other stuff, irradiance. It just is making life simpler. My core skills would be like hand-drawn drawing and visualizing without the aid of computers. So it would be your own sketching skills mainly, and your own coloring, and what I believe is work hard as much as you can, and then things will fall in your place.
Lauren and Chris, with new technologies coming into the market, how do you feel your field is changing, and how will you adapt?
Oh God, it's changing because I mean, media and everything is so involved in, you know, image is everything at the moment, and it's not always about talent. You have to have the talent, and then you have to look good, and everything has to, you know, be well presented, and so
graphics. Pull the package.
You've got to have the full package, and it's all about media.
But luckily, they can do all the thing on the Photoshop where they put out all the fat lines and the wrinkles and stuff. So you don't have to worry as much, but you have to kind of look good from the start.
I feel you have those.
So wrinkles and that.
Well,
he's an old man, really. So
96.
So you feel like you've got your image right for your market?
We're still playing around with it.
Yeah. You know, it'll come with time, and obviously you've got to change with times as well. I mean, if we look like something from the 70s, that's not going to work now.
Yeah.
So you've got to go with that flow as well.
Oh no, 70s is back.
Oh, it's coming.
I was going for like 40s, 50s, but you know. Also, you can blag freebies off students, you know. So it's great because they obviously need to design stuff for you.
Which online platforms are you using? And are you just using online stuff, or are you still very much using grassroots marketing techniques, flyering, not just knocking on doors?
Oh, well, MySpace is probably our...
That's the one at the moment,
isn't
it?
Biggest plug at the moment. That's just... But the thing is with MySpace is there's so many MySpaces out there, and literally there's probably 100,000 billion artists on there that people who don't already know who you are won't know to look for it. So the thing is you can only sort of spread word of mouth at the moment, and it's people who stumble upon it, and the likelihood of anyone...
It's like the technologies are there, as we said, but you've got to get everyone to join in on that. You've got a MySpace page, but you've still got to go out there and get everyone to check it out. Yeah, it's out there, you know.
It's about promotion and word of mouth half of the time. I mean, because if you don't have the technology at your finger...
MySpace, Songbird, by the way.
Yeah.
And our audience, live audience, make some noise for yourselves again. How do you feel about it?
I think it opens up doors, obviously, if you're able to use different platforms to upload your content to, and it allows maybe for a wider audience, because instead of just maybe trying to get your film, for example, or music or whatever, through normal conventions, you're able to do it through internet, webisodes, anything. Nowadays, with technology, you're allowed to do that.
Are you making any webisodes of your own?
Not yet.
I saw technology is obviously changing the way we as a society use and interact with it. I was lucky enough to be granted a meeting with the crazy Laszlo Jones of Rockstar Games and the Grand Theft Auto series to find out more about the demands we, the consumer, put on the industry to cater to our needs.
Grand Theft Auto 4, you just download it straight to your Xbox. It's a whole new story, new vehicles, new characters, new weapons, new radio, new hip-hop, new rock, new television in the game. It's huge. Us in Hollywood don't get along in a lot of ways because video games are sort of starting to steal thunder of movies, and that's because it's so much better value for your money. If you buy a video game, you could be playing for 50 hours. You see a movie, it's like, great, there went my 20 quid, you know?
These type of games are what people are calling a cross-platform medium. Do you think it would ruin the GTA concept if there was ever a film made?
Oh yeah, Hollywood's approached the founders of Rockstar numerous times and said, we want to make a movie, just cinematic experience. You are in this city, it's like you're living in a movie that you can control. To do a Grand Theft Auto movie would be difficult because then it's one person's interpretation of what's happening, and everybody in the audience is going to want to be grabbing for a controller going, no, make him go left, make him go right, no, hit, punch her in the face. You know, so it would, I don't think it would work as a movie.
So how does the gang situation in the game work for the whole interactivity of it online and stuff? Can other people control your friends that with you?
Because, you know, people loved all the different online games that they could play. For Grand Theft Auto 4 The Lost and Damned, we've got all new missions. So it's basically like you and your crew here at this radio station can all be playing online as one motorcycle gang, and the competing radio station can all be a different motorcycle gang, and you can just go rumble. Yeah, man, and everybody go check out Grand Theft Auto 4 The Lost and Damned. You can download it on Xbox Live and go to rockstargames.com and click on The Lost and Damned.
Be careful. See you later.
Yeah, so I know everybody here must have played GTA. Play it.
Yeah. No, you take the lead
on
that one.
Laszlo told me that a big amount of the people that play are females. I was hoping you'd be one of them.
Really?
I'm afraid
I'm not.
I know, I have to. The thing is, just general game playing, I tend to suck at it, and I don't do things that I suck at because I'm a sore loser and I like to win.
One interesting thing I can tell you about the conversation with Laszlo is GTA is an open world game. You don't have to follow any type of mission. You can just live your day. You can go to the shop, get eggs, ride a motorbike, whatever. And kind of, he also mentioned that these games are taking the place of a lot of the movies and stuff. So would you rather stay in and play 9 hours of GTA for free after you've bought it, obviously, or pay 50 quid to go and see a 2-hour movie?
Oh, I know where I'd be. I'd be straight at home, get my chicken here, you know, get the game on. I might even get some chicken on the game. That's how it should work, really.
And you guys play GTA?
Yeah, of course.
Big fan?
Hey, it's a good game, but you cannot compare it to cinema because it's totally different mediums and different messages, because this one goes into, it's like very one-sided. It's like good action game, but then it's only about action. Whereas in film, you have your diversity. So it's different mediums. They're all exciting, but I would still probably go for a good film.
I liked the story in it, man.
The story is like really good. I mean, the violence that they get, the better, obviously. But after a while, I mean, like after a certain level, you're like, oh, well, I know where that is going. And if you've been following all those games from the beginning, you pretty much can figure out, you know, how it's going to be.
I now feel bad that I'm just like running around the street slapping and shooting people. So everything we've discussed so far has involved technology, probably why we're considered to be a nation of couch potatoes. So we're going to look at some physical art. Capoeira. You guys in the audience have a think about what you consider to be a legitimate art form and have your questions ready.
Two styles of capoeira. One is the capoeira Angola, and another one is the capoeira regional. The capoeira regional, you will see, that's the one that I teach and I taught, and the first capoeira I have learned. The first time, the only people who were practicing capoeira were the black people who came from Africa. When they start spreading in Brazil, what I have, they had somehow to survive. But there was not enough jobs to everyone. There was not easy living conditions at all. So they had to survive the way they could manage. When these people came to the north of Brazil, they brought with them all the culture, the food, the costumes, the religion, and the capoeira itself. They used to live in a place called Senzala. It was like a huge farm where you have the white people who used to own the farm, and they used to have factories as well, you know, so they couldn't escape from there, they couldn't defend themselves, and then these guys, they're training inside of the music. They were playing the drums, they were having the music, they had the claps and everything, and they disguised the training, the fighting side of the music to pretend they were not training. Messi Bimba, Manuel dos Reis Machado, his full name, he was the creator of Capoeira Regional. His father was the king of Batuque, which is a dance with drums as well. And it's very similar with a dance which you can find in Martinica, in our Martinican island. And while they were playing the drums, his father used to play the drums, they were kind of dancing, swinging from one side to another, and suddenly some kids would appear in the local dance. Mestre Bimba was a very wise man in the martial arts side. He knew a little bit of everything. So he just mixed them up and he took all the capoeira which did exist before and then he gave the name of capoeira regional. I always compare the capoeira regional with IT, with technology, because we are always recycling, we are always updating the movements, we're creating new things, and it's always an evolution. Even the capoeira Angola has slightly changed, but very, very little. Okay, because the capoeira, the Bangoleiros people who practice capoeira Angola, they keep more roots of the first capoeira than the capoeira regional. So capoeira regional is really, really, it is faster, so you have, you train more upstanding than on the floor. I respect capoeira Angola a lot, and I think you have to have more strength. Well, the Jinga is the first movement that everyone will learn in capoeira, the very first. Will be a move that will practice to the rest of your life, because everything starts with the Jinga, all the kicks, all the acrobatics. Capoeira without Jinga doesn't exist. It's a way to confuse your opponent, if you can say, to trick the person, because there are many ways to swing from one side to another before you even think about doing the kicks. When you do a Jinga, you have time to analyze, you have time to think. We could compare capoeira game to a chess, because it's not just about being fast, it's not about being strong, it's about being clever, it's about being very smart. It's psychological and spiritual as well, because when you exchange the energy, if both sides, both people got a good energy, you will have absolutely amazing game. Something will happen somehow inside of the hodo, which is the circle where we play the capoeira in the middle, and everybody else around will be able to feel, even when people clap or when they sing, all the intonation, the instruments, they start going a little bit funny as well, you know, they lose the connection and the rhythm. Everything, when you watch a capoeira hodo, you can clearly see that if you can't feel. I just fall in love with them, the energy, the style of life, and the passion they had. I try to put a little seed in every single person who passed in my class, you know, and everyone who comes to my classes, to our group. They will find a family more than a martial arts group.
That was a very educational and informative piece. The history, the links to slavery, the traditions. What do you guys think it is about the culture behind capoeira that has made England embrace it?
Probably the passion and just the fact that, I mean, it is an art form. Anything that you use to express yourself, I think, is art, you know?
It's so free-flowing and kind of, like interpretive in a way that they just... There's no real structure to it, which is music from the start as well, you know, you've got to kind of free flow it to get your sounds and get what you want to do, and then you kind of think, right, I need to structure this a little bit more, but that maybe capoeira could be used by everyone, basically, yeah. And then move on from there.
Basic form of art, there's no sort of restraints or telling you how to do something, it's improvised, and improvisation is, you know, is something
it's the ultimate doodle
time.
Dance.
Yeah.
And just the way you talk about it makes me feel like it's free, it's expressive. Yeah. In these times of credit crunch,
art should be free, you know, if you can make some money. But at the end of the day, if you enjoy doing art, then you don't need to be paid for it. You should be able to give it for free.
Well, but,
you know,
try and make some money anyway. You can do it for free and it doesn't cost you anything. And, you know, that's what art is about. And I think that's one thing about sort of industry and you know, technology at the moment is it's expensive. And I think that's why things like the record industries are going down, because, you know, CDs are expensive to buy. Mm. And that's why people are having, you know, lots of people are stealing stuff off the internet and, you know, films. And we've all done it. We've all watched a pirate film. We've all done
not
it.
Not me. I'm
not not you. Not you. But, you know, capoeira is free. It's, you know, it doesn't cost anything. And that's what art should be about. I mean, it's just us, me, him and a guitar at the moment.
So guys in the audience, what do you think about it all? Do you think capoeira is a legitimate art form?
No, it's about some poor people with no TV. They probably just go outside to dance, you know.
But then it's still a legit, a
legitimate art form that can be practiced, like you're talking about, without, there's no real financial restraints, which is one of the beauties of it, I think. Anyone can go out and practice it, maybe like join a club, but no real financial restraints. It's open to anyone, and it's people expressing themselves, so definitely, I would say a legitimate art form.
Yeah. This is very much like dancing. I've always wanted to see some capoeira versus crump dancing. I think that'd be pretty heavy. So great questions, man. Now, personally, I've always wondered how to make myself stand out in a crowd. Individuality is the key. So have a look at these recording artists and see how they've manifested individuality into their work. Asher Roth and Laura Isabel.
It got sent to the UK, it got sent to LA, New York, and I showcased. I just kept, it's old school, you see, that's the thing, Joe. People are like, you got discovered from a demo. It's like, yeah.
Not on MySpace.
No, MySpace, on a demo. The music is actually really everywhere in a really low-key way, and people can connect the dots and be like, oh, that was opportunities to work with these big names, and it just looked, you know, and I considered it, but it just, to me, I just looked around and it just seemed like that's what everybody was doing. Was, you know, I said it before, but bulletproofing their record and their project, that they have X, Y, and Z here, and this person making this beat, and this day. And there's nothing wrong with that, and that's something I'd love to explore next record. Yes. But for my debut album, you know, you always have to look at your albums if it's going to be your last one.
Album is released on
May 18th,
in the UK.
I think people listen to music differently nowadays. It's very much iPod shuffle-ish. No one's listening to just hip-hop, no one's listening to just rock, no one's listening to just, you know, this with MySpace, I wasn't promoting it or anything like that, but I had the Kanye freestyles and DJ Premier freestyles and stuff like that. Yeah, and now here we are, man, anxiously awaiting the debut of the album. We have I Love College, which is the first single. People are automatically going to compare it to something. That's just what they do. You know what I mean? They're like, this comes out as like, to understand it, you compare it to something else. And with my case, you know, not a lot of white rappers have broken through to the mainstream. The hardest thing really has been differentiating yourself as an artist. And really, what are you trying to accomplish? Who are you? You know what I mean? And that, I think that's a battle for everybody, though. My whole ordeal is much more songwriting and, you know, and creating music, rather. So, you know, people will start to understand, when they hear the album, they'll really start to understand it, that it's really blending, starting to blend genres of music. It's not really straight rap, you know what I mean? You know, the motives of these rappers have changed a lot. You know what I mean? A lot of people were originally getting it, you know, it was about enjoying yourself, self-expression, and, you know, empowering people. And then it turned into just getting money. I appreciate the need for financial freedom. You know what I mean? It's a capitalistic country, you know? And when you create music and you're creating music for the mainstream, you need to be glorifying the right things. You need to be saying something. Do I understand the business side? Yes. Do I think that's what should be glorified, the getting money part? Absolutely not. I just want to know what happened to the music, man. It wasn't until recently that I kind of found my own voice and really found who I wanted to be. And that took me having a conversation with myself and my support system around me. Like, what am I trying to do? We're going to make some moves, especially making this a global movement rather than just in the States.
Yeah.
It's very possible that Wayne and Busta Rhymes could be on this track called Lions of Roar. So I don't know where I was going. What were we talking about again? I kind of lost my train of thought.
Lauren, Chris, Songbird, what makes you individual and what makes you different?
Well, every artist is individual. Everyone's got their own sort of unique signature. And I mean, I think it's just that we kind of like to do our own thing instead of copying other people.
I think our difference is it wasn't a case of we were both looking for someone to fill the gap. Like, we were both happily to maybe go solo with it. But because of us joining the way we have, like, I like to be a perfectionist on the guitar and like to always get the newest, betterest, newest thing. I'm not convinced that I've got the best out of it. And Lauren's almost the same. She's always trying to perfect the thing and get it better and better. And I think with that double up there, that we're not trying to help each other, we're trying to almost contradict each other with that perfection there, that we could probably end up doing something that could even shock ourselves. But
I mean, neither of us are very into really mainstream sort of stuff. Yeah. Because, like, I mean, when I grew up with Frank Sinatra and Nat King Cole and Ella Fitzgerald, and, you know, so I
real music.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I grew up with so many different things, and, you know, you were more into your ska and your Blink 182, and then sort of
that was mainstream.
Yeah, I mean, that was mainstream. That's your mainstream bits. But, like, I don't know. I think as we've got older, neither of us have really sort of hit the whole sort of like, oh, well, that's on the charts, we've got to listen to that. Like, we always try and find sort of different kind of inspiration, different sort of people who you haven't really heard of that aren't, you know, and they go, oh, that's, I really like what they're doing.
That's right. I mean, there's a whole world out there, and we don't want to think that, like, when we make, like, what our idea of a, hey, this song's really good, we're not going to stop there. We're going to try and better that, because that song's going to be old news in a week. So that whole perfection level might just push something out new for people there. So,
what sort of new technologies have you been using to promote yourself as an artist?
MySpace is probably the most technological thing we've used.
That's about it.
Technological.
It is the thing of the internet. You know, there's so many things you can use on there, but at the end of the day, you put yourself on, and then you go and get your audience as such. You know, so you know, use MySpace, use all these other ones that I've probably not heard of yet. But at the end of the day, you can have something floating around the internet, but no one's going to touch it until they're told to touch it. So
exactly.
You still have to go out there and be like, look. Go on to our MySpace /Lauren Bannon, and then
I mean, it's all about promotion. It's about, you have to do the gigs these days because there's no money in the industry. Record companies are losing money and they can't afford to invest in new artists. So to get yourself known, it's not, you know, obviously the internet helps, and as I was saying before, it enhances it, and it's a link and you know, it helps nowadays. It's not like having to send 100 CDs to record companies. Now they can, if they know about you and they've heard about you, they just click on your MySpace, listen to your music, and yay or nay, and that's kind of how it goes. And so it is a good link, but then at the same time, I think you've got to have the basic talent and the basic rawness there before you can even put a step forward, and you need to do it sort of manually almost. Yeah.
And the whole idea of that whole shameless plugging, you know, that's what you have to do now, because that's over there. You've got to shamelessly plug it to hell for anyone to look at it. And it seems that our culture is going to be based on shameless plugging, if anything, now. So
I really want to discuss one thing with the audience. And I'm like, we were talking about individuality. And I feel a lot of the artists within the music industry feel like they're being individual. But if you look at the charts, there's a lot of the same thing out there. So how do you guys feel about that?
It's not about like how you promote it. It has to be like a good quality to start with. You know, there has to be good quality content and music, and then you take it from there, because all these acts which are promoted, I mean, for, you know, like boys or girls bands, whatever, they don't provide any lasting impression. And that's where you have your fight with culture versus commercialism.
So do the individual looks over here, would they make you buy Songbird's album?
Or, well, let's hear their music, then we decide.
I think there has to be something distinctive about their music that makes me want to listen to it, that's different from anybody else. If it's the same as somebody, some other band, then I'm not going to really want to be interested. I might listen to both of them, if you know what I mean.
So we've covered a lot today, and it's all part of an ongoing debate. If you at home want to get involved, hit us up on the forum, www.freshair.com. Next week's show is going to look at how President Obama stole the hearts and minds of America. So thanks to Songbird for coming in today. And Songbird are going to perform one of their tracks right now to finish today's show. All of today's information about them will be available on www.freshair.com, and you can find their MySpace on there also. I'll be presenting my radio show as usual on Oxford's 107.9 FM with Mr. Specs and the rest of the Fat Club family tree on Saturday. Thanks again for watching, and peace.
The last time we laid on the floor and we stared at the ceiling above, talking for hours, acting like kids and falling in love and falling in love. When was the last time we joked and we laughed and we mapped out our dreams with a plan? When was the last time you held my hand? last time.